Friday. I miss you, David.
Okay, we're ready to get started. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I'll give you one more shot at it. Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
As the county executive always says, it's a great evening in Prince George's County that we're here gathered for the third of three listening sessions that the county executive has held around the county. I want to welcome you. My name is Barry Hudson. I am the manager of communications for the county executive, and I will be facilitating tonight's listening session. The purpose of the session tonight is to give you all the opportunity to share your thoughts, your ideas, and your concerns with the elected officials here in the county. This is not a session where there will be a back and forth between the elected officials and yourselves. What this is your opportunity to share what is on your mind. Often you go to events where you listen to elected officials tell you what's going on in the county and around the state. And today is your opportunity for you to share what you're thinking and give them the opportunity to listen so that they can look at ways that there could be legislation either at the local level or the state level to address some of the concerns that you have. So the key word tonight for them and all of us is to listen. The things that you will have and you will say tonight, although they may sound like things that you're concerned or angry about, for us, they are hidden behind all of that is always an idea that could lead to legislation. So we'll be listening attentively, and people around the room will be taking notes. Before we get started with a few introductions, I do want to acknowledge the principal of the school, Principal Prince, and her team are here over here in the corner of Great Potomac High School. Give them a round of applause. Did you want to say a few words of welcome?
First of all, good evening, everyone. My name is Robin Prince, Principal of Potomac, and I have my administrative team, Mr. Kenneth Calvin, Ms. Carla Pierce, and I recognize two staff members, Mr. Essex and Mr. Valparso. I'd like to say welcome. Thank you for coming to Potomac. We are so happy to have all of you all. We always welcome our elected officials, county executive, and all of our elected officials, especially our state.
Very good.
Before I give the elected officials sitting at our table here a chance to introduce themselves, I'd like to introduce some of the other elected officials who are here today. Sitting here on the front row, I have Delegate Aisha Braveboy. We're also joined by Councilmember Mel Franklin. And we're also joined by Councilmember Karen Tolles. Sitting at our table, we also have a delegate and a senator. We have the chair of the delegation sitting here with us, and I'm going to turn it over first to Jolene Ivey to say a few opening remarks.
Thank you so much. Thank you for doing this, actually. It's really helpful to hear from people and to understand what your concerns are. I don't know if you realize it, but last year when we had these listening sessions, the part of the outgrowth was actually the bill that changed the structure of the school system. And you may not have realized that's what you were doing when people got up and spoke and they kept thinking that our county executive had authority over the school system. And it seemed that, well, maybe we should make it so that he had more input and was able to do more for our schools. So that's actually a direct result of these meetings. I did want to say that Delegate Aisha Braveboy is not only a delegate, she is the chair of the Black Caucus. So I didn't want to let that moment pass. And, of course, a candidate for Attorney General, but I'm not giving a plug or anything. Thank you for coming out. I really appreciate it. I'm looking forward to hearing from you.
Next, we will have Senator Muse, please.
Thank you very much. Good evening. And it's good to be here, and I want to welcome you and especially our county executive and the chairperson of the delegation to our 26th legislative district. I welcome them here, and I do applaud them for all of the work that they do. All of what we do is teamwork in Annapolis. We work very hard. I'm glad to be at this school. This is a school that we worked with, Councilwoman Tolles, in bringing $125,000 back to fund the improvements for the track and stadium and work to get the sidewalks on Boydell Avenue that you worked so hard to help us to get. We're here, as we said, I'm here on behalf of our Senate delegation. I serve as the vice chairman. Our chairman, Douglas Peters, could not be here, but he wanted me to say to you that we work hard together as a team to do all that we can in Annapolis. There are 23 other jurisdictions that we compete with in terms of funding and all else that we do. But because we have a good team, not only in the House and in the Senate, but here back in the county, we were able to bring back more money for capital projects and more money in terms of the schools. And I can put this plug in for the 26th legislative district. We're able to bring back, with the help of all of our colleagues who concurred, more money in this district for school funding and reconstruction than any other district in the state of Maryland. And I owe that to our colleagues who worked with us to get that done. So we're here to listen. We're here to hear what you have to say. It's our pleasure, and we're grateful that you've come tonight. Thank you.
I'm going to ask Councilmember Tolles to say a few words real quick.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to District 7, but really welcome to the southern portion of, I think, the listening session for Prince George's County Executive Sharon Baker and our delegation chairs. And I'm also thrilled to be here with my good friend and colleague, Mr. Mel Franklin. We work very closely together to bring back resources in partnership with our partners in Annapolis for the southern part of the county. And so we look forward to hearing what you have to say tonight and to let us know what our assignment is as we move to the 2014 session. So I'm just happy that you all are here, Mr. Baker, Mr. Franklin, and also candidate to Senator Muse for re-election. Mr. Baker knows I always have his back. So I
yes, you do.
Is that my clue? Yep. How's everyone doing this evening? Good. It's a great turnout. I, Senator Muse and Councilwoman Tolles, it is always good to be in the southern part of the county because they always turn out for these sessions. Let me do a couple of things, if I can, before we get started. First of all, if Councilwoman Tolles could stand up and Councilman Franklin could stand up, and we can give them a round of applause. They're great individuals. I don't want anyone to think I did that because they will have my budget in a few months and I need them to pass it. thank you. Why not? That's it. But, you know, we always start off these hearings this way, and that is there are a number of your government that's out here tonight. And if I can, and they will do this as quickly as possible, if we can have the members of the Prince George's County agencies and directors. And why don't we start with our fire chief? And if you can come up and introduce yourselves and let them know who you are. This way, if you have complaints about various agencies, isn't it great to know they're actually here? So they can't escape, so you get to see them, you get to see their shiny faces. They're so happy and thrilled. They will be thrilled to talk to you. Starting with our fire chief, please. Chief Fisher.
Fire chief, if it's good news, talk to me. If it's bad news, talk to the police department.
Don't be shy.
Everybody, I'm Hank Stawinski. I'm the deputy chief of police. And it's all good news in Prince George's County these days. We know that. We just need to adjust things a little bit. So.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. I'm Greg Harris, Deputy Director of Operations at Department of Corrections. And you have a very, very safe and secure jail.
Didn't somebody just...
Stand up, Rick, so we can see you. Don't be trying to hide.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Linda Lowe. I'm the Public Information Specialist for the Department of Environmental Resources. I'm here on behalf of our director, Adam Ortiz, who is unable to be here tonight, and I know you only have 2 minutes. Thank you very much.
Is there anyone else that we missed? Oh. Terrific. WSSC? Mm-hmm. Yeah, we love you.
My name is Kevin Wolfright. I am your customer advocate. I've been at WSSC for 35 years. Most of you probably already seen me in your communities supporting various events and projects. I am on 24-hour call, so if you need my cell phone number, I can give you a business card. We'll tell you. If you dealt with me and you know I provide excellent service, and my word is what I say it is. My job is to make sure my customers are happy and get the excellent service that WSSC provides, as well as other resources that we provide. You probably don't even know. So again, glad to be here with Kevin St. Baker and everybody else, and glad to support.
Great. Very good. Do you guys want to tell them who you guys are?
I already did. So.
Did you?
Lisa Jackson. I am manager of
Intergovernmental
Affairs.
Courtney, do you have a job today?
Hello, I'm Courtney Glass. I'm an attorney with the Intergovernmental Affairs Division.
Right. Is Denora here? Oh.
Denora Hernandez, a Latino liaison for the county executive.
I thought I saw Calvin. Oh. Oh. Why you wait till the last minute, Aubrey? Tell me who you are. That's all right, we'll point him out.
Good evening, my name is Calvin Wong, and I serve as the council liaison
on the county executive. Yes, he did. Somebody said he took Carrie's job. Yes, he did. Did we miss anyone? Jackie, are you representing who tonight? Can we give them a round of applause? They do a great job. And Principal, I want to thank you for having us in your terrific school. I have them do that at all of the hearings because this is your government. And these are the individuals, the men and women we've asked to provide you with quality service. It also are the folks that I rely on every day to deliver the service to almost a million people that we have in Prince George's County, 500 square miles. That we have to service. A couple of things I'd like to highlight before we get started tonight, since this is the longest they let me talk. One is we have our public safety officials here, Assistant Chief Stawinski and Chief Bayshore and our Deputy Chief for Corrections, but all of our public safety of individuals. In Prince George's County, this is something that doesn't get a lot of attention. Crime is at an all-time low. We're at a 35-year low. Our homicide rate last year was cut in half, almost cut in half, by 33%. We reduced our homicide rate. If you think about that in comparison with the rest of the nation, almost every other jurisdiction or state reduced their homicide rate in single digits. If everything goes right, Chief Stawinski, if you knock on wood, we're actually on pace to even lower it from the 33%. That right there would be record-setting, not only for Prince George's County, but throughout the nation. And the reason we're able to do that, and I'm sure if you talk to Mr. Stawinski, he'll tell you this, is not just because of the work that's being, the fine work being done by the police department, the fire department, corrections, state's attorney, and the sheriff's department, but also by the work that's being done in Teresa Grant's office and family services, by Homeland Security, by social services, by our transportation, by our work with our legislative partners. As a collaborative, we're able to reduce crime, but we're also able to provide services throughout throughout this county. None of this would be possible without our partners at the state level. You know, I'm so pleased to have the chair of our House delegation. I know that's a hard job. I had it. And she's doing a phenomenal job, not only helping us deliver education funding from here for Prince George's County, but also helping us with the authority to make the changes we need to make to bring in what I think is one of the best CEOs or superintendents in the nation, but also helping deliver resources for our hospital. So I also want to thank the Senate, and especially Senator Muse, for his efforts in helping us with building not just a hospital, but a regional healthcare facility, but also making sure that we connect healthcare throughout Prince George's County so that Fort Washington and Southern MedStar is not forgotten, that each and every part of our great county is delivered. The other thing he's making sure of, and I thank him for this, is that we're going to, and many of you probably may talk about this tonight, there's a new Tanger Outlet Mall will open in the southern part of the county. It's a great thing. You know, just think about it. People are actually coming to Prince George's County to be entertained and to shop and to spend money. That's good for us. But it also means there are things we need to take care of, like infrastructure. How do we make sure people get in and out, in to spend their money and out to go wherever else they want to go to? But we need to make sure that we're providing the resources to do that. And we can't do that without our partners in Annapolis and our partners at the federal level. So tonight is your opportunity to talk to us. As Delegate Ivey said, you know, we take these hearings very seriously. That is why each and every department comes out. We take notes, whether it's legislation or things we need to change within our agencies or comments you have, but they're helpful to us. One of the things that we started when I was chair of the delegation, Senator Muse remembers that we came into the House together, is, you know, a lot of times people would put legislation in and then people would come down and testify on behalf of it. What we wanted to do is actually go out and hear from you first before we actually introduced legislation and got behind legislation, because, you know, you're where the rubber hits the road. You're where decisions should be made. It is impactful in your lives, and so we want to hear from you. With that, I will turn it over to Barry Hudson, and we will start the process. Thank you.
Okay. As the song says, let's get it started in here. That sounded a little corny the way I said that too, didn't it? But anyhow, let me give you a couple of rules of the road. I just checked mine. I was supposed to sing that. That would have been even worse. Let me give you some of the rules of the road. I just checked mine. I'd like you to check yours. Make sure your cell phones are either on vibrate or turned off so that we don't interrupt our speakers. Also, to be aware that each speaker will have 3 minutes to speak. Lisa Jackson will be providing you time reminders at the 1 minute mark and the 30 second mark with the lovely pink sign. I want to make sure that everyone's respectful of that time, and if we start saying time, it's not because we're trying to shut you down in terms of your comments. It's because we have about 29 people who need to speak. So we want to make sure we move through them as rapidly as possible so everyone has a right amount of time and everyone has an opportunity to speak. In addition to that, I do want to say that over here in the corner, from our Office of Community Relations, we have someone, they're waving her hand there. We have someone from something the county executive didn't mention, 311 or County Click, which we started this year. She will be there taking any requests that you may want to submit after today's meeting. So she will be there as well if you want to go over and record that. The second announcement that we want to make, you can't do an event without commercials.
Can we have her introduce herself?
Sure. Could you introduce yourself real quick?
Hi, my name is Ivaria Paxton, and I am one of the co-takers at the 311 call center. So I am the bilingual call center representative, and I am here to assist you if you have any requests that you want to submit to the county. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. One of the other things the county executive didn't mention that I want to make sure we talk about really quickly is that last year, about 18 months ago, the county executive introduced what is one of his signature programs, which is called Transforming Neighborhoods Initiative, that he launched in six focus areas around the county. And starting actually tomorrow night, we'll begin a series of open houses around the county for those neighborhoods that are affected. So the first event will be tomorrow night, November the 14th, at the Suitland Community Center that covers the Suitland area. On November 18th, we'll be at the Templeton Elementary School that covers the Riverdale area. On November 20th, we'll be back here at Potomac High School for the Glass Manor, Oxon Hill area. On December 9th, we'll be at the Prince George's Ballroom for the Kentland-Palmer Park area. On December 11th, we'll be in Langley Park at the Langley Park Community Center. And on December 18th, we'll be at Hillcrest Heights Community Center for the Hillcrest Heights area. So if you live in one of those areas, there will be information that you will get or know about to attend one of those meetings. So the rules are set, and we're about to go. So our first speaker, please come to the mic over here, is Margaret Bowles. And on deck is Dorothy Simmons.
Good evening, elected officials. Thank you for having these listening sessions. As a volunteer working with several groups that serve our county's homeless and working poor, I would like to address some of the pressing needs of our county citizens. The Human Services Coalition, many churches of all faiths, and many citizens help stock the various food banks that open their doors to help serve the poor and needy in the county. I am asking you to continue to support in the budget this united effort that multiplies our tax dollars 50-fold because of all the volunteer services that go with the Human Services Coalition. Next, I would like you to focus your attention on supporting the efforts of our new superintendent of schools and his effort to improve the reality and the image of our public schools. All of our children need safe, friendly environments in which to grow and learn. They need to have access to good art, music, and athletic skills programs as part of their school day, not add-ons that poor parents cannot afford to provide their children. When I go to statewide competitions, even countywide competitions, it's easy to see that our students are starting from a less enhanced program than other counties and private schools. We have just as many gifted and talented students, but they are not getting the same advantages as their neighbors. This needs to change, even though there are less tax dollars. I taught in the school system for 30 years. Thirdly, I'm asking you to fully support the 10-year plan to end homelessness in our county. This government initiative is supported by county, church, and nonprofit efforts partnered to identify persons needing assistance and exploring possible solutions. However, they are doing so on a very limited budget. Both state and county entities need to provide sufficient funds for adequate social networks such as emergency assistance to prevent homelessness, increased numbers of places to provide emergency shelter for people living in their cars and in the woods. They are not invisible. They do not like the situation they find themselves in. They do not choose to lose their jobs or have the accident that disabled them. Okay, I'm gonna jump right to the end and I'm gonna give my statement to the lady over here. Early identification programs need to be part of the school system, but the health department also needs to develop a program to educate parents about the needs of their children. We have an awful lot of domestic violence because of crowding in many, many places, particularly Langley Park.
Thank you very much.
You take it? Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, please.
Dorothy Simmons.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My main concern today is the Prince George's County public school system. As a parent coming from the private school sector, it's very disheartening to have the students in the type of environments that they're in. And if you looked at TV today, when they had the executive technology team on the Hill, we can see a difference in our community. We are not providing the technology in our schools and the education to have our kids ready to compete and to have those type of jobs on the Hill. If you look at the folks that represented the executive technology committee for the president, we see the folks that are spending the time and the effort and giving those education to those kids. We as a community, the richest black county in the country, should have school systems, not just four or five in our county, that supports technology for the students. Every high school, every elementary school, every middle school should have technology and arts programs so all kids have the opportunity to excel in those environments. It is disheartening, and I would like Prince George's County leaders to take this initiative on because we are being left behind. I've actually started substituting in the schools just so I can understand what happens. Our kids are really being left behind. The new programs and standards from what I see that we have in place, some of the kids are being taught, some of them are not. But it's not only on the schools. That goes back to the households as well. But we have to, as a community, make this a priority. I don't think I should pay the taxes that I pay every year and then have to turn around and pay and put my child in private school for her to get the education that she deserves and will need to compete and excel in America as a whole. And until we as a community make that priority, right, the kids will never succeed. They have to have the opportunities, and I beg you, because I am definitely now considering going back to private school, and that's not fair to me, right, as a taxpayer. Now, if you're going to give me my tax money back, right, I'm okay with it. But if I'm going to have to continue to pay the taxes, I definitely need my representatives to work on this for my community.
Thank you.
That's my issue.
Thank you.
Next speaker is Denise Rush, and on deck is Charles Pate.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My concern and issue is, of course, blindness, disability in the community. our money is good, it spends, but we don't have accessibility, we don't have housing for handicapped, and when I say accessibility, I mean we get an apartment and the tub, we can't roll into the bathroom and take a bath because it's a tub. How are you going to roll that anywhere? We need to have more facilities that are really accessible. We need to have an extension like they're going to Dulles Airport with the Metro. It needs to be extended further down Branch Avenue so that we can go spend our money down in Waldorf, in Clinton, places we're making it accessible. We want accessibility. Every movie theater should have a row at least so that I can go to the movie and know what's going on just like everybody else. But that's in Virginia. But every movie in Maryland should be accessible for blindness, for handicap. On another subject, I want to talk about not just handicap, but we need to have in our schools for the children to learn how to spend their money, make financial decisions, because we're not, the adults aren't doing it. So we got to start at the schools and know how to spend your money, how to write a check, how to do your banking, how to purchase a home. If we start that earlier, then we won't have the problems that we're having now. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Charles Pate, and I live at 2812 Bellbrook Street in Temple Hills, Maryland. I moved to this county, I think it was February 1973, to the same house, so I've been there a little over 40 years. My children graduated from this high school, and I need your help. You can see that I'm a senior, and I got great, not only grandchildren, great-grands. And what happened to the money that was designated from the federal government to either renovate this school or to build a new school? Whoever was in charge in the county should be held accountable. If they lost that money, and I understand it might be 5 or 7 years that the money might come back to the county, but whoever was in charge certainly should be held accountable for that. I'm a service-connected, partially disabled American veteran. There's a few people might not know that there's a clinic for veterans who are homeless at 860 Chesapeake Street in Southeast Washington, which is near my community, which is Temple Hills, Maryland. Now, the Maryland governor came to our neighborhood some years ago and said, good news for Branch Avenue and Temple Hills, Maryland. Good things are coming to your neighborhood. But apparently, Homeland Security didn't wind up over there in Crystal Skate. So we have now, I'm just thinking, it just crossed my mind, we had about a decade ago, we went months and years with the height plan. And our neighborhood still does not have. And I have Senator Muse and our new Karen Toll, and they know me both very well. I want something built in my neighborhood soon. I'm not talking about a decade when I'll probably be gone. I mean soon. I want something done in my neighborhood. I live a block and a half from Nail Road Metro Station. I can walk to it. We have the Legend Nightclub, which they say is prime property, sitting vacant right in front of Naylor Road Metro Station. What's happening? Why we can't get somebody down there? And she said, I have 30 seconds. Okay. That's perfectly all right. And the last thing was just please try to get something to come to my particular neighborhood. I'm part of Mr. Earl Gum Group, and we are the Hillcrest Heights Civic Association, and we vote very, very heavily in our area. Thank you.
Yes, you do. Thank you.
Just as a reminder, as you're sitting here, if you have written testimony of any sort, remember that you can submit it here tonight. Courtney, if you raise your hand, you could submit it to her either before you leave or after we're done here, if you'd like to do that. Moving on to our next speaker, Amelia Stewart, and on deck, Raymond Colbert.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening to our county executive, distinguished members of the state and house, and the county and school board members, as well as everyone here that serves our community and the people that are a part of it. I have but one concern, and that is the state of our schools, and I'm sure it will be reoccurring this evening. Currently, if I'm not mistaken, our schools rank somewhere near the second last in our state, and this is a travesty. Why is this so? Is it a lack of resources and supplies or a crumbling of infrastructure that includes our schools? Is it a lack of parental support or teacher performance or a lack of diligence on the part of our students? Of course, the answer is all of these things, but the question is, why, what are you guys going to do about it for us? I mean, if we have all of these problems and they continue on and they're not being rectified, then why are our voted officials, why do you retain your salaries if these things cannot be rectified? We continue to speak on these issues, but they have not been solved. Education is the root of all problems in our society. Yet we continue to let it be the last on our list of things to fix. How long are you, our affected, elected officials, willing to allow inequality in our education system to continue the widening gap of disparity between our children and the children of other counties? My plea is that education will not only strengthen our community, but it will strengthen the economy of this county. With small business owners, that's something that education breeds. It will bring more jobs and more opportunities to our county as a whole. The concept of equal education is sacred. It's as sacred as the building that we're sitting in today. Too bad that it's not held as sacred anymore. I hope that after tonight, we will take a stand to change these things. And please, I would love it if our community will receive answers tonight that are not mundane. The mundane answers that we continue, continuing to get to keep us at a stagnant complacency. Please give us answers that will mean something to us, not something just to keep us quiet and in the same place. If our elected officials really, really, truly love the county that most of you come from, I assume, then you'll make these changes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, elected officials.
Good evening.
I'm gonna ask y'all a question, get y'all a picture. Say my house, the shatters, windows, broken windows, leaky gutters, and I'm going to go to your house and tell y'all what a great way I could fix your house. Would y'all believe me? No one. Okay, second question for y'all. How many people in here know about Prince George's County transit system? One? Very few. This is my issue, public transportation. Because see, every election we hear how concerned we are about transit-oriented development. Now, every single time they tell you about Metro. Metro, of course, is not only shared with Prince George's County, shared with the federal government, Virginia, and DC. Y'all just said y'all don't know about your own transit system. There's 8 different ways to get in and out of DC. It's only one to get around Prince George's County, Maryland. That's through cars. Now, I know what y'all saying. He has the transit, but you only got the car. He's talking about we could only get in out of cars. Well, let me ask you this. How do you get to Metro? Metro got to start in D.C. That's how they strengthen. That's why you could pretty much walk around in D.C. and catch a Metro. The other two is obviously bus and cars. The bus system here, we do have Metro, but guess what? It's only a handful of cities, which obviously does not service all of Prince George's County. The other one is yours, and guess what? They close at 6, because we all know businesses and close around 6 o'clock in Prince George's County. They does not service your county. Now, what if we expanded not only in this county, but within the state of Maryland itself? What opportunities have we had not only within the county, but within the state? And the Ravens go to the playoffs in the Super Bowl. How much money would that bring in to the state? How many people in Maryland could be employed? Because those types of jobs will not leave the state and cannot leave the county. Now, Donna Edwards says that we're trying to attract federal, in order to attract federal jobs, you need a transit system. How are you going to do that when you can't even access it within your own county?
Thank you. Next up, we have Tommy Michaela, and on deck, Angela Heath.
Good evening. My name is Tommy Michaela. I am a resident of Accokeek. My highest priorities are education and good governance. First, I urge you to work to minimize the amount of standardized testing that is done in Maryland schools. I realize that due to federal requirements and overall demand for accountability, there is need for some standardized test. However, we have gone completely overboard with these tests. As a result, our kids spend an inordinate amount of time taking standardized tests. If my calculations are right, my son last year had standardized testing on at least 27 days of school. According to my son, not much teaching happens on those days when testing is done. All this is taking time away from actual instruction. In reality, many of these tests are being administered just to prepare our students for another standardized test. So not only are we teaching to a test, we are also testing to a test. This is complete insanity. And it is not only the time. Our students suffer from the narrow focus on math and reading that results from the tests. Our teachers are frustrated and demoralized as they have become standardized test administrators rather than real teachers. Administering these tests is also very expensive and takes resources away from other priority areas. It would be one thing if this test mania was proven to work, but it is not. This is not what the highest performing school systems in the world do. At the very least, I urge you to direct the State Department of Education to order an independent third-party evaluation of the actual time devoted to standardized testing and test preparation, as well as calculating the direct and indirect costs associated with these tests. We must have an honest discussion about the benefits and drawbacks related to all this testing. Now that we are moving to Common Core and testing tailored to it, it seems like a good time to have this discussion. My second priority relates to election reform. I urge you to get rid of candidate slates and their sample ballot advertisements. In lower ballot elections, such as Board of Education races, candidates' slates formed by incumbent politicians decide the election results. Let's take my district, District 9, as an example. Next year, whichever Board of Education candidate gets on the sample ballot of our local incumbents will be more or less guaranteed victory in the race. This is completely undemocratic, and it effectively disenfranchises us voters. I want us voters to make the decision in these important lower ballot races, not the incumbent politicians. Even if you are not willing to push for actual electoral reform, I urge you as incumbent politicians to refrain from endorsing candidates in lower ballot races through your slates and sample ballots. Please let the best candidates win on their own merits. Thank you for your time.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having this session. My name is Angela Heath, and I'm here today from Physical and Sports Rehab. Physical and Sports Rehab is a for-profit physical therapy clinic located at 1401 Mercantile Lane in Largo, Maryland. Paul Heath, my husband, is the founder and executive director of the clinic. During his 15 years of experience as a physical therapist, he encountered many uninsured and underinsured patients who needed rehabilitation care and education. In order to help address this need, we founded our nonprofit arm, PTS Rehab Works, to provide low to no cost rehabilitation services, general health education, nutrition counseling, and wellness education. 13% of our population comes from the neighborhoods within the Transforming Neighborhoods Initiative. Within that 13%, a full 73% are residents from Palmer Park, followed by another 14% from Suitland and Marlow Heights. I am here today to voice our need for continued support from the county for healthcare services. The regional medical center is years away, but there are small businesses, nonprofits, and healthcare providers who are here and ready right now to meet the healthcare needs of Prince George's County. Help us do just that. PTS Rehab Works is centrally located in Prince George's County and accessible by public transportation. With the county's support, the clinic will provide free physical therapy services, healthcare education, nutrition, and wellness counseling to individuals and families residing in Prince George's County. Our goal is to empower people to be proactive in their healthcare and to provide a stronger relationship with their healthcare providers, thus improving the communication and quality of care received. Our health assessment will determine which programs best fit our patients' needs. Some of the programs include a physical therapy and rehab program, diabetes hypertension program, diet and exercise program, nutrition counseling programs, healthy living and wellness programs, weight loss program, and a corporate wellness program. On the one hand, you have this tremendous need for health education and addressing health disparities in the county. Then on the other hand, you have healthcare providers who want to help solve these problems and offer solutions, but there's no infrastructure in place to support this on an ongoing basis. As an example, we want to create this rehab center that will address the health concerns of the county. But as we look for physical space to do this type of work, rents are $23 a square foot, which we're currently paying on our space. We have a 2,500 square foot clinic now. We're paying $23.75 a foot. So it equates to about $5,000 a month. This makes it very difficult to meet the healthcare needs of the people. There must be some way that the county can help offset this cost for nonprofits and businesses such as ours. Perhaps the county could provide nonprofits with an incubator space. The criterion could be the same mission that's in the Transforming Neighborhoods Initiatives. We are aware of the community partnership grant and we'll be submitting an application next week. And I thank you for your time. Okay. Yeah.
Our next speaker is Lori Arguelles, and on deck, I didn't introduce her earlier, Mayor Jacqueline Goodall.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I wanted to begin with words of thanks and appreciation, because very often when you come to forums like this, what you hear are the problems, and we all know that there are plenty of them in our community. I have the privilege of running the Alice Ferguson Foundation for Environmental Education. We're based in Accokeek, Maryland, and we serve Prince George's County students as a complement to the education that they get in their school system. And I hear and appreciate all of the concerns, and sir, I want to thank you in particular, Mr. County Executive, for the investment that you have made in getting an excellent leader in for our school system. I have great faith that Dr. Maxwell will help carry out the vision that you have for Prince George's County, the vision that all of the people in this community care about and want to see the very best for their children. So we are privileged to be a partner in delivering that education service on our 330-acre working farm on the banks of the Potomac River, right across from Mount Vernon. You should come and see us at some point. And I also wanted to compliment you on the Transforming Neighborhoods Initiative. We are really pleased to be a partner with you through our trash initiative. The Potomac River provides 80% of the people in the watershed with drinking water. Not everybody's on a well. So it's very important that our river is clean and trash-free. And so that's our investment in the community. And I hear there's a lot of talk about public-private partnerships, or P3. I even heard somebody refer to it as P4 today. It was somebody from the federal government who really wanted to make sure the public was a part of it. So it was public-public-private partnerships. So in any case, I just really want to thank you for the investments that you have made in our community. We look forward to continuing to be a partner with you in carrying out the vision. And we truly appreciate that we'll be able to be a magnet for not only the county, for the state, for the country, but for the world, as we build one of the world's only living building challenge certified buildings, where we're really going to challenge what the future looks like. Many people are aware of LEED certification process. It helps to mitigate the effects of development, which I'm sure is another concern that folks have in the community. And so we really look forward to no net energy, no net water, carbon neutral, non-toxic facilities, and leading the way for the future, and hoping that Prince George's County can be the incubator for green business, green buildings, and green technology. And I think that's in perfect alignment with the vision that you have outlined. So thank you for all that you do, all of our elected leaders. We're proud to have Mel Franklin represent District 9, where we live and work. And it's tough being in government service. And I appreciate everything that you do. So thank you.
No, thank you. And I should say they have like some of the best eggs down there that they grow on the farm. So those of you from the South like me, you'll like going there and having the eggs. Yes, Mayor.
I want to thank you tonight for allowing us to come. And I don't feel offended. I'm used to Forest Heights being forgot. We're
Never.
The only municipality that's in this district. We're inside of the Beltway. We're kind of tucked away. And a lot of people don't even realize that Forest Heights is a municipality. However, we are, and we have been doing our part to move everyone's agenda forward. Sometimes we've had to do it alone. And that is one of the problems that I am having as the mayor, is not having as much support as I possibly can from my other elected officials. When we not only work within Forest Heights, we work with all of the communities surrounding Forest Heights. I want to thank Alice Ferguson because we are one of the towns that is a Forest Heights, a trash-free area, and we've been working with them about 4 years. So I want to thank Alice Ferguson also for their support. My concerns is not only the concerns of the TNI, I am concerned that the TNI doesn't extend beyond the borders. There's a lot of things that have happened where I have heard and I have talked to people and they have said, oh, well, you're not in the TNI area. This is a complaint not only of mine, but of all of the mayors inside of the Beltway that are bordering the TNI. We have the same problems as the areas of the TNI. Matter of fact, we have a lot of the overflow problems. And so we need help in our municipalities that are bordering the TNI just as well as the areas within the TNI that are in the county. I'll probably get hit by Mayor James about that because he said, don't say anything about that, but I'm going to complain, y'all know me. One of the things that I see happening along Oxon Hill Road is that you have sidewalks going up and that our existing sidewalks, and those sidewalks are being renovated. Well, I have on Livingston Road, where we have heavy traffic, no sidewalks, where a couple of weeks ago, I had a gentleman that was in a wheelchair, and they were doing construction on putting the lights up, and this gentleman could not even go down the road because they were using the shoulder of the road to pass cars. So how was he supposed to get from Glass Manor to the shopping center? I want to ask our county officials for support of the sector plan, which I think is great. I also ask that Forest Heights Elementary School, which is a great school, which is doing a lot of great things. They were in the Science Bowl, if anybody doesn't know. Go to Forest Heights, Maryland, or Forest Heights, MD.gov, and you'll see that they were in the Science Bowl. They need some help. They were built in 1953, and nobody has been there since then. I have spent $10,000 out of the funds for town of Forest Heights at that school. I, as a small municipality, should not be spending money to help an elementary school.
Thank you.
I'll be talking to you guys. Right.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Next up, Alicia Bealty, and on deck, David Turner.
While we're waiting for her to come up, I'm so pleased we're to be joined by my chief of staff, Glenda Wilson. If you could stand up so everybody could see you. Hi, Glenda. Representative from the southern part of the county. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening. My name is Alicia Beatty.
I'm sorry.
And I'm a resident of Foster's Overlook, which is a community that's kind of within Southview Apartments, right on Southern Avenue. And so as a resident who lives pretty close to the new outlets, the new Tanger outlets,
yes,
I'm very concerned about traffic. And I know that you mentioned that. But I want to say that down this, in this Southern Maryland area, this Southern Prince George's area, outside of the roads and improvements that were done along with the Wilson Bridge project, I have not seen in the 12 years that I've lived here, any specific road improvements, any road widening here in Southern Prince George's County. Now we have these outlets going up. Pretty soon we're gonna have a casino coming in. Fortunately, I drive opposite traffic. I drive to Charles County every day, but I see the people coming northbound and they are bottlenecked every day. There needs to be some legislation going through about road improvements or public transportation systems, improving public transportation systems for Southern Prince George's County. Within that, and I find it interesting that National Harbor, Maryland, Oxon Hill, Maryland, both have 20745 as the area code. I just want to make sure that there's appropriation for more increased officers. As we know, any area of increased shopping, especially an area like the outlets is going to bring increased crime. So I just want to make sure that I bring that point to your attention. The other issue that I have, I want to make this side note too. You said that there were 29 people on the list with a 3-minute time limit, but we had a board advertise us to start at 7, but we didn't start till 7:30. So that means that there's potentially that many people that might not get the chance to speak. Just wanted to put that out there. My last concern is this. I am a primary and a general election voter, have not missed a primary or general election since I became a resident of the state of Maryland. Last year in the general election, in early voting, which I did at Oxon Hill Library, I waited for over 4 hours to vote. We need to get increased funds toward going toward ballot boxes, personnel, et cetera, so that me and the other, however many people, and there were over 1,000 people in line, do not wait 4 hours for early voting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, county executive, members of our state and county representatives. I'm Dave Turner, and about 3 years ago, county executive, I was talking to you on the Kojo Nambi show, and they had called up and said, Turner, you got anything to say about historic heritage in Prince George's County? And I said to you, we need to meet all these tourists that are going to be coming to the Potomac River at our casino, at our outlet malls. And right now they're all going over to Old Town or going into D.C. to see their historic heritage. The NAACP, which I'm a member, was very concerned about the fact that we have nothing here that will begin to pull all a section, a part, a small part perhaps, but a big number of tourists to our heritage sites, particularly in the Senator's District, but throughout the county, and frankly, Maryland, because we've got the tourists coming here so that we can send those interested in seeing something historic elsewhere. The NAACP and the African American Heritage Preservation Group, of which I'm also on the board, said let's start it on our own because park and planning isn't going to get involved. You suggested I talk to Matt Nitze and the Visitor Center, and he works Six Flags and family reunions and a little bit of National Harbor. But what we need now, because it's happened, we're going to have a tourism center at Tanger Mall. We're going to have a memorial garden that tells the slave story in Prince George's County at Tanger Mall, and that garden is twice the size of this room. This visitor center is going to be open at every hour that the Tanger Mall is open. We need some help. We need a little bit of money. We need to get a tourism strategic plan started. Let's have a clean industry. It works. It brings money to the county. It brought money to Old Town, and Washington lives on it. So we look forward to working with you on your various funds that you're going to be disseminating, and maybe to talk to Wayne, if you would, to see if maybe we could get some mitigation money for a real South County effort, not just the foundation in North County, but get some of that MGM money cycled in to help us fund this effort. Thank you.
Thank you, David.
Next up, we have Tiana Glass.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Tiana Glasgow. I've been a resident of the Sutler Landing Development down the hill for 10 years, and I've also been the vice president of Glass Manor Civic Association. My concern tonight is for the safety of myself and for my family. In my neighborhood, there's land erosion, and I've contacted 311. I've contacted Departmental Environmental Services and was told there was nothing they could do for me. So my concern is, I'm sorry.
That's all right, take your time.
The land around my neighbor, around my home and my neighbor's homes is eroding. My neighbor's homes are separating. Mm-hmm. We live in a town home unit, and my concern is, what do we do? You know, what agencies can we contact? I had an inspector come out because my foundation is cracked. Theirs has cracked. My issue is, you know, what resources in the county, you know, can we turn to or have someone come out and inspect this? Because the water sewer and the landlines run directly in front of my home, and the inspector told us that it's possibly water line under the land, which could cause a sinkhole or something. And, you know, they said the retainer wall behind our units are cracked, and it could be detrimental to all of us. So I'm asking, you know, what can you do to help me?
Courtney, why don't we do this? Courtney and our 311. If you can, we can.
Thank you.
Just get the information.
So and I've contacted WSSC. I was told that they don't have any records of our engineer plans on file. So they only can tell me where the lines begin, but they can't tell me where they deposit to. I've contacted the county regarding the permits because after some investigation, I noticed that the permits showed that the foundations had initially failed inspection.
Yeah,
and when I called the county to inquire.
We're going to help you right now. Courtney is going to take your information. We're going to get over here, and we're going to make sure that that we get that information. Thank you. I don't know who's here from.
Ms. Key. Ms. Key.
Thank you for coming out. Tiana is also my daughter, and she's my assistant at the Glass Manor Civic Association. She's a single parent with two kids. I'm proud of her. But my question tonight, I always challenge Senator Muse. There's food banks out here. I volunteered for 2 months, and what I saw go on, I was disgusted. I quit. They make you wait in line until they take out what they want, and their friends pull up, they load them up. Well, in my neighborhood, I have seniors. Mm-hmm. Sometimes Sister Green and myself will go get the food because they're on fixed income. We'll go get the food and distribute it to the seniors. I have seen them mistreat the seniors. One of my neighbors refused to go back the way they talked to the seniors. I want to know, are these food banks monitored? I know one in Landover, they shut down because they were selling the food. So I'm just disgusted to see this going. My question is, if you not, is anyone monitoring these food banks?
Is there a food bank in particular you're talking about?
Sure.
Yes.
I would get with you guys, but like I said, I volunteer and I saw, you know, when people come, they don't come because they just come. And a lot of people are on fixed income, and now that they're cutting food stamps back, the lines are getting longer. Like I said, I volunteered for a while. I was just so upset the way people was being talked to, mistreated, fights, and I would like to see the food banks monitored.
Well, Lori Valentine from our office is right here. She's going to get that information for you so we can get some investigate this. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Isn't it great to have the government here so we can actually get problems so you don't have to, you know, wait for a return phone call? Amen on that.
Here. Next up, we have Tamara Davis Brown, and on deck, Dennis Cerati, is that correct?
Yes. Correct.
Good evening.
Good evening, Tamara.
Thank you all for having this public meeting, and good evening to my fellow neighbors. I'm coming on a couple of state issues, then some county issues. As we know, Delegate Ivey and Senator Muse, that the state's basic responsibility in terms of delegate is to bring back the funds to the county so that we can get some of the programs that you're hearing about or the needs met. And my first point is that we continue to need school construction dollars in South County. There's a concern that we don't have enough of quality schools. We need more new construction schools, or we need to upgrade like this facility, like the new Oxon Hill High School, of some of our older South County schools. Our kids attended John Hanson Montessori School, which was actually built as a ninth grade extension to Oxon Hill, but it's not retrofitted for pre-K 3 years old. It's because this is Montessori, it starts at age 3. It's not retrofitted for that. And unfortunately, my daughter had a terrible accident as a pre-K and still to this day has a deformity in her finger because the door was so heavy that she could not, she had to be rushed to the hospital because of that particular incident. So I'm still asking for us to look to bring more school construction dollars to the county. Also, we need a new CIP project here in South County. I know that we are doing some redevelopment for transit-oriented development along Branch. Thank you for coming out for the groundbreaking for the project with Mr. Swartz. But what about Naylor Road? What about Camp Springs? There's a community group that is meeting to help put in an application that will go to the state for grant funding for redevelopment of along Camp Springs and Allentown Road. So we want to make sure that we have our state partners on board with us there. We want to keep money for funding for 210 Indian Head Highway at Kirby Road. I understand that there's a group that wants to take that money out of the SHA budget. We want to make sure that we maintain it, and we really need to expand it to handle the traffic that's going to come for the casinos, the Tanger Outlet, as well as National Harbor. We also want to bring more SH funds for upgrades along 210 past Kirby Road. And then finally, with respect to the casino, if we could get the ear of the video control board to make sure that they hire First Source County residents, not only for the permanent jobs, but also construction jobs, because we saw with the building of National Harbor, license plates outside of Maryland parked there doing the construction work. I have a whole slew of county issues, but I just want to say that we need to bring equity to South County in terms of park, recreation, and school curriculum.
Tamara, thank you. And I'll
put the others in writing
from you over the next few months.
Say again.
I think we'll be hearing from you over the next few months.
Yes, you will.
Thank you.
Thank you. 4 years, maybe.
Distinguished guest, County Exec, Senator Muse, Karen, Councilperson. My name is Dennis Surrett. I'm president of the Barnaby Manor Civic Association, Citizens Association. And I know that, and let me tell you, just over, I've retired from being the president of the telephone union as well. So I just want to say that I want to thank you guys, first of all, for giving the kind of attention that you've given to TNI. I think we've got a lot of things accomplished out of that. I think the senior citizens have been thanking us as well because of all the facilities they've gotten. But I also have a concern. That concern is our schools. And the concern also is people who are losing their houses in Prince George's County. I think that this is something that has to have an immediate emergency type of situation. It's not a situation that we can sit on. We will never change our area with all the crime going down and all the things that have been happening here unless we can start to improve our schools. I believe that Clayton Drive, I happen to live on Clayton Drive, and I like that sidewalk going down the hill on the other side, on the other street. But I think Clayton Drive, because all the school buses come down there, also needs a little bit of work as well, perhaps maybe another sidewalk as well. But I can't say enough about house losses. I can't say enough. I hear this at my meetings. We've had great attention with the police, fire department, all the public situations. I love the idea that you guys are coming out here to us instead of us trying to find you guys wherever you are. I think that's perfect for me. But so I just wanted to let you know that there are things that I think I can applaud you on, and there are some things that I hope that you will listen to us and take it with some real concern. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next up would be Edward Stevens, and I'm probably not going to say this right, Zeno St. Cyr.
While we're waiting for them to come up, we've been joined by our Deputy CAO for Public Safety, Barry Stanton. Can you please stand up? We're near your T&I area.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you kindly for your listening ear. It's a pleasure to be here this evening. And
good to have you.
I have one concern, is that the front foot benefit here in Prince George's County. My journey started in 1995. I put a contract on a house in 1995 and went to settlement. House fine, everything fine. Went to settlement. Then at the beginning of the year, I got a bill for front foot benefits for $800. Now, my concern is, I know the front foot costs money. I understand that. I know it costs money. But there's no regulation on these developers coming in and charging anything they want to charge for the front foot. Case in point, WSSC put 12 houses in my development. WSSC put the first 12 in. They charged $5,000 per household. Developers came in, and they put the lines in, the sewage line and the water line. They charged each homeowner $15,000. That's a $10,000 jump. Mm-hmm. And what really got me upset was when I went to my neighbor's house, two doors down from me, I tasted his water. My water didn't taste no better than his. I flushed my toilet, and my toilet didn't flush no better than his. So how can it be justified? And so I've been fighting this since 1995 in the courts and all, but there's nothing is happening in this county for those developers coming in and charging anything they want to charge. And I thought mine was bad. And went to a meeting at WSSC. I think Doug Peters put up a meeting on, and some people were paying $20,000 to $30,000 for front foot. So there's no regulation to charge anything they want to charge. So I just don't understand how since 1999, when WSSC had stopped putting the front foot in, and they let the contractors do it. I called WSSC. They say, well, there's nothing we can do. I said, well, maybe not anything you can do, but your customers is pretty blooded up by the time they turn them back over to you.
Thank you very much.
Good evening.
And good evening.
Thanks so much for coming on out here to South County. I am Zeno St. Cyr II. I'm the president of the Riverbend Citizens Homeowners Association, also the chair of the Transportation Committee for CETA, and a co-founder of GSCAP, the Greater South County Coalition for Absolute Progress. I want to speak to you tonight in the time that I have about an issue that I have a lot of passion about, as I'm sure many of the elected officials here already know, and that's transportation. I think next to education, transportation is probably the most important issue for folks here in South County. It certainly is up there in the top two or three. We've got so much development that has already taken place here in South County, and more is coming. National Harbor is now an employment hub for the county. It is also an economic engine, not only for Prince George's County, but also for the state. I applaud you, Mr. County Executive, for the letter you wrote to WMATA to keep the National Harbor One bus transportation service here and encouraging them to expand it. We also testified in that regard as well, but we need more. With 900 employees coming to Tanger Outlets, with the prospect of thousands more employees coming to National Harbor if the casino license is awarded to MGM, we really need to get heavy rail. We need to extend the Metro's yellow line across the Woodrow Wilson Bridge and have it connect with Branch Avenue the green line at Branch Avenue. We are working, CETA and GSCAP are working on a project that we think might help to address the big elephant in the room, and that's the transportation issue. When we have that project a little further developed, we would like to come down and meet with yourself, our other elected officials, to present those ideas and see if it's something that will help to make that transportation issue a reality. In my closing remarks, let me take one hat off and put on my Salubria Memorial Group hat. You've already heard from Dave Turner. We will be coming to the county to ask for some funds for the visitor center that we view as a gateway to Southern Maryland's historic sites. We encourage everyone to come on out and visit the site when it's open. Not only the Memorial Gardens, but also the visitor center. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Sandra Shirley, and on deck's Maxine Henson.
While we're waiting for them to come up, I understand that LaVon Thomas from our Community Affairs is here. Is LaVon here? They're right in the back. She's excited about talking to you also. Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having this listening session. This is my second session that I've attended. I would have been at all three, but the first one, my schedule would allow.
Thank you for coming out.
And I want to tell everyone, there are more of us than they were at Roosevelt High School, even though it was a smaller room.
That's right.
So I wasn't at the first one, it's at Greenbelt. And you know, this is an advertisement, so don't put this on my time. But thank you all for being here and for listening, delegates, senators, Mr. Baker for holding this session, county commissioners. My name is Sandra Shirley. I'm also the vice president of the Barnaby Manor Citizens Association, and I'm speaking though. On both hats, but I'm also a member of Justice for Homeowners, which exists to help homeowners in or facing foreclosure, excuse me, by collaborating with others, individuals and organizations to expose and combat wrongful foreclosures in Prince George's County, Maryland. We are proposing legislation, and you know, especially for this legislative session, that is critical to helping, we believe, homeowners in before they get to a court foreclosure by requiring the court to send an affidavit to the homeowner who is being subject to foreclosure to allow them to affirm that they have received all legally required notices and information, and that that must happen before the court can issue or approve an order to docket, which is after the order to docket takes place, then the person's foreclosed on. And then the next step is selling the house, et cetera. And then also in this affidavit, affording them the opportunity to appear in court. The proposed legislation simply ensures that families who make up the more than 10,000 foreclosures in the county pipeline already will not be illegally foreclosed due to lack of legally required notices, procedures, services, and information. A simple checkbox on a one-page form is all that's needed. Either you got it or you didn't. And it's on the homeowner to do this and send it back to the court. This is one small action that could make a tremendous difference in the lives of people facing foreclosure. I'm not going to go into this. This has been submitted electronically to the county executive. I want to sort of flip over a little bit. I attended yesterday some of the budget hearings at the county, as well as the Prince George's County 2035 meeting. Specifically regarding schools, the infrastructure for schools regarding technology has to address last mile. That's not in the Prince George's County 2035 plan, which will govern planning or framework for the next 30 years. Universal service funds will help the county in terms of money because the Federal Communications Commission provides that money that the county can apply for schools and libraries. I've been talking about this for more than 3 or 4 years, so I hope that we do something with it because the county's not getting that money. Secondly, The 2035 plan, I wish I could have seen you all there last night, has very little for South County. It needs to be there because all of these recommendations about transportation, about schools, Southern Prince George's County is not a priority investment for the 2035 plan. Well,
first of all, thank you for coming and thank you for coming out the other nights.
Good evening. My name is Maxine Henson, and I live in Temple Hills, Maryland. My grandson, he attends Potomac High School, plays with the varsity on the football team. And one of the things I wanted to bring to light is they keep talking about that they're going to rebuild the stadium and the bleachers and the track because Potomac has one of the worst fields in the county. And there's no reason that these children have to play on this. When you go to any other school, almost in PG County, in which I go to all his games, Leonardtown, I went, which is outside of PG, but if you go to any county school, you'll see a better field than what they have to play with. And it's ridiculous. The other thing is, how in the world, and it's so embarrassing, that they have an article in the Washington Post that says PG County had money earmarked for Potomac High School, Crossland, like $1.8 million, but they didn't secure a contract with a contractor by May 31st, and then the money went back to the federal government. How did that happen? Can you tell me? I mean, that's ridiculous. We need money in PG County. The kids here at Potomac, they keep saying they're going to build a stadium. They're going to do the fields. They're going to fix it up, the weight room, everything. But they don't, you know, have the money for the school, and they need to do something about it because it's ridiculous. Now, I voted for you. I voted for the casino. You know, that money's supposed to be going to the schools, and I'd like to see something for it.
Thank you.
Next up, Liddell Lewis and Horton and Gloria Bell.
Greetings, everyone that cares about this community. I wanted to start off by giving you like a small scenario. Well, I know as I walked around my subdivision and I was handing out this newsletter that I compiled, I noticed that, and this newsletter talks about TNI, advertise this meeting, because it's important. And I came across a neighbor, and the neighbor told me, he said, well, I mind my business and I stay in my house. And I thought, if something affects my property value, it is my business, and I'm going to go check on it. So being new to the Oxon Hill area from Flint, Michigan, and I know you all heard of Flint, Michigan, and I'm a new homeowner, and I'm highly invested in this area. So because I'm so invested in the area, I took it upon myself to find out who was the person over my homeowner association, because I do live in Foster's Overlook, and I told him I want to get involved, and he thought I was crazy because I came to him. So they plugged me, put me involved, and also I happened to get one of the flyers that was advertising TNI off the street because it blown off the street from down the street. So I picked it up, and then I went to the meeting. So I'm the only community member on the executive board for TNI under Mr. Barry Stanton. And
Barry's happy to have you.
and not only that, I choose to volunteer locally because, you know, I'll rather help your children here at Potomac where I live instead of calling these people over here to come and arrest them.
There you go.
But I ran into a small issue. So one of my major things was to make sure that the youth are college ready because when I went to Michigan, they paid for my bachelor's all the way down to my PhD, and I made it my goal to help other people, especially people that come from disadvantaged backgrounds, to excel. But when I came to a school in PG County, I was told that I had to pay money to volunteer. Now, when I say pay money, not okay, you paying to play, but basically you have to pay in order to get your background check and fingerprint. And I was like, hold on. If I'm giving you free labor, isn't that an investment in me? So it was troubling to hear that I had to pay to do this. It almost changed my mind based off of principality of loan. But I propose that two things happen. To show that you value your volunteers, in addition to simplify the to get the burden off of the volunteers, how about you waive the fee or you refund the fee after they complete a certain amount of hours? Because the community need us.
That's a good idea.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Horton and Gloria Bell. Horton and Gloria Bell.
Good evening, my favorite legislator, my favorite Senator Muse, my favorite executive for many, many years, and Suplow, and my favorite county council member, even so that you are not my county council member.
She's as cute as can be.
First thing, I have been all my adult life a resident of Prince George's County. So I don't tell you my age, you can figure, okay? Now, as a point of information, for the people they call Prince George's County, PG, I get to the point they say, oh, this person is a new in the county, they do not understand this derogatory name for the county. PG is not such a thing county. It's Prince George's County. It's a project we started about 25 years ago. And it really bothers me about that. Now, the issue that I have today are kind of simple compared to the one that has been addressed. For example, the beggars. What made our county look bad? Every corner is a beggar asking for money and asking to be killed. We stop in the corner of Indian Head Highway and Palmer Road, and the beggar just running from car to car for money. One of the things. I called 311 as the executive gave it to us, and I was so excited to have their number, and the lady in 311 want to give me another number to call. No, the 311 should be, I have an issue, I call the 311, that person take the information and act upon my information. I don't have the time and the car and everything to another number and call the thing, no. I give you the information, please act upon this, sir. A second, there are some here. Oh, the vendors. Right now in National Harbor, we have lost two stores. Right. And these two stores, one deal with bags, the lady's bags and everything. Fossil just left. In the meantime, right in Livingston Road, Livingston Square Mall, every Saturday, a man come in boxes and boxes and boxes, open a store, play signs in Indian Head and Livingston Road, and you get the guy get customers every time, count 10 people, buying bags and purses from these people. We bring in the outlets. It's a competition from a person that don't have a license, that don't pay taxes in our county, and take the customer from the merchants in our area. We have worked very hard to bring all these stores. And I said we worked very hard because I used to serve in the Board of Economic Development when we used to have to go out the county to sell Prince George's County to the merchants that finally come here. So we have to be there and support them. Swarovski also have left. In the meantime, our people in the Indian Head Highway sending bracelets and everything. So these things have to start immediately.
Thank you.
Another item. Well, the casino.
Time.
Oh.
Thank you very much.
Just make sure, just make sure you see Courtney after the session. She'll be glad to take down the rest of the information that you have.
Okay.
Okay.
Also, I have an information from a couple that goes to Andrews Air Force Base. They run all of the red tidies. And this lady informed me that her neighbor have robbed Wilders and they're selling drugs.
Ma'am.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Our next speaker is Mawa Karen Johnson, and following her will be Margaret Bowles.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I had an opportunity last week to voice my concerns, and I wanted to stay in your face, so that's why I'm here today.
Very good.
I'm Mawa Karen Johnson, and a resident in District 3, and my concerns are around the Turkish American Community Center and the construction.
And you know, I drove by there just by way of, yes, after you spoke last week, I did drive by there.
Great. And I was referred, Councilmember Turner's office referred me to Chellis Whitney, but she has not gotten back to me at all. Okay. But anyway, it's the Turkish American, I'm glad you had an opportunity to go by there too. It's located on Good Luck Road between Elvis Road and 97th Avenue in Lanham, and I'm a resident in Lanham. It's been a year now, and we've been living through the construction there at that Turkish American Community Center. It has negatively impacted the residents with the noise, the digging, the vibrations to our homes. Down the road, we may have realize that we've sustained some kind of property damage from the vibrations. As I mentioned, there are five structures that are being built on that site. A mosque, a monastery with dormitories, there are 16 rooms per suite, a fellowship hall, a Turkish bath, and a community center, and then they want to build these 10 houses. And the property is not that big. We're being saturated with, I think they got a piece of land and they just decided to go crazy and build, and build and build. The owners were supposed to have contracted another construction company because they have a commercial construction company, Balfour Beatty, and they are really accommodating. They even put up construction signs for us. And but the other company, they have not gotten to construct the houses. And Balfour Beatty told me that in order to get those houses constructed, they needed a modification, an addendum. And what I'm hoping is that those 10 houses do not get constructed, and that they they're renting one of the houses already in the neighborhood. Let them buy the houses that are there for sale. They help transform that neighborhood and renovate those instead of building other houses. And I would like to take a look at that land use and see if it is oversaturated, and if you can do anything about preventing the re-permitting of those houses, it would be greatly appreciated.
Thank you. And and I'm going to talk to Aubrey from our, because I did go by there, and you're correct.
The site is impressive.
Yes, it is.
Yes.
It is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Margaret Bowles? Okay. Benita Bratton, and behind her, Sister Joy.
Good evening.
Good evening.
A lot of you know me. One of my biggest issues in Prince George County, currently I own two homes here, one in council members Toll's district and council members Mel Frank's district. My townhouse is fine. The condo, I've come into a lot of issues, and one is that the state and the county is doing nothing to protect these homeowners and condos associations that you say we must have. I've been fighting to get management companies licensed. kids with lemonade stands or for me to have a yard sale in my community, I have to have a license. These management companies are $1 million business. How many times have we seen on the news where they've taken our money, they're not giving the citizens the service? Where I live at Tribeca at Camp Springs, our condo fees are anywhere from $300 to $500 a month. The state says they have to be that high to keep the outside appearance of the place up. Inside, it's a mess. But not only that, there has to be some regulations of these management companies. We're told that we can live there forever and they can't wash the windows. I mean, you can be there 30 years and your windows never get washed. Another big issue that I'm concerned about is that there's no teeth in the county and these outside developers know it. We keep referring to the Common Office of Community Relationships. Right. On their website, they have a disclaimer. I can't do anything to you. All I can do is talk to you. I've stepped it up. I've gone to the Attorney General's office. I went there in May just to ask what are the requirements for a condo board to hold a meeting. It is now November. They haven't answered that question. They pit me against my own attorney, a practicing attorney, and they will not make a decision. Well, maybe they can do this. No, what does the Maryland Condo Act say? If there's a rule, you follow it. You just don't say, well, this is what someone else does. But I challenge the county to take back your county and regulate these developers and these management companies because they are totally out of control. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, and good to see our community in strong turnout. My name is Sister Joy. I'm a full-time poet, author, motivational speaker, arts advocate. I wear many hats, and so when I signed in, I just put my name as citizen because I don't want to represent any one entity tonight. The arts are what I'm here about. I'm here to speak in support of the arts as a means of providing opportunities for persons of all ages, but especially the youth, to experience richer and more meaningful lives. This is not simply because the arts are a nice or fun thing to do, but because the arts can be a means to discover oneself, one's abilities, and the world in which we live. Individuals can discover and develop their abilities through the arts. The arts can bring communities, cultures, and generations together. The arts convey ideas and issues that may be difficult or uncomfortable, but essential to articulate. Cultural understandings can be forged through various artistic genres, whether poetry, dance, visual art, or any of the myriad other forms of artistic expressions. The arts have been proven to provide a financial base for communities where the arts have been embraced. The arts can provide employment and opportunities for business collaborations. Art is a multi-billion dollar global industry that offers international opportunities for persons connected with the arts. I'm speaking firsthand. My first trip outside the United States was as a poet traveling to the UK, where I performed in London. Poetry and other art forms can make a difference in people's lives. Opportunities for artists and the need to be funded by our county government, as well as in collaboration with state and federal entities, is essential. More grant opportunities, as well as county-sponsored workshops, artist appearances, and arts discussions need to be held in the county at accessible locations, not only on campuses and in libraries. Whether it's an arts-based venue such as Annie's Art Gallery or faith-based venues such as Ebenezer AME Church, the arts
can be a vibrant and necessary means through which our communities are enhanced, enriched, and young people in particular see their worth and come to understanding who they are. Too many times, persons in the arts, more specifically persons not connected with the arts, never hear about arts because those events are not taking place in non-traditional venues. By the very nature of artistic expression, the host and the funding of arts or events has to be in places where the people are, not in glass towers that are academic and sterile. So please consider that. Thank you.
Thank you. And I want you to know I'm a big proponent of the arts, and I think we should do a lot more, especially funding and purchasing of especially visual arts. And congratulations on your show. You do a great job. I don't know if anybody's seen Sister Sojourner. Can we give her a round of applause? She does a great exposing the arts in the county. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Zaylee Harris, and on deck is Donna Warren.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
I'm glad to be here.
Glad to have you.
Above ground. I came here tonight to do three things. I want to compliment you on one thing. I want to talk about education, of course, because that's my forte. And I want to talk about, I want to ask a question. So my first question is, what is this rain tax? How are you guys going to assess that? Do I collect water and tell you about it, or I really would like to, I'm serious, I'm not being funny, I really would like to understand the rain tax. I know you can't tell me, but maybe in between or afterwards or in closing. Just a little bit, okay? Thank you.
We can help you with that.
I also want to thank the police.
Thank you.
I want to thank you guys. There's a feeling of safety when I go places after dark around Prince George's County. You guys are in strategic locations. Your lights are on. If I'm in trouble, I can drive up to you. There's a sense of safety. You know, where's a cop when you need one? You can actually say right down the street on the corner now. And I appreciate that. So give you a round of applause for that. And I also want to talk about education. As an education advocate, I moved here in 1990. My daughter graduated from Potomac High School in 1992 as the class valedictorian with a 4.71 GPA.
All right.
And went on to college, dual degree now. And if I tell you what she does for Lockheed Martin, I'd have to kill you. But one of the things that I really want to talk about is the fact that there are 19,000 plus school districts throughout the United States, and not one majority minority high school actually outscore academically its wealthy or its white counterparts across town within its own district. There's a reason for that. I think that I would like to ask the state legislators to consider a piece of legislation. So I'm going to need just a little bit more time. Just give me a few. I know. The legislation I'd like for you to consider is to break up the state's the state board of education. I think that board needs to be broken up and become an elected board. I think it needs to align with its congressional districts. I think there should be hearings so that we'll know who our elected, those board members are and what they're about. I think that they need to answer questions about the workforce development school system they've given us by zip code. And I think that the actual superintendent, state superintendent, should be a cabinet position on the governor's, just like you have done on the county. And I think that those state board members should have a term, or should be term limited. And we can get into that more. I wrote a piece of legislation in 2004 that was actually adopted by an Anne Arundel delegate. It did get several hearings.
Time.
I do have copies of that bill and would like to share that with you. All right, thank you.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'd like to thank all of you who've come out tonight. You deserve a round of applause.
Yes, you do.
Today, you've heard people talk about jobs, infrastructure, transportation as it deals with Metro, education, the environment, the arts, and health. I applaud Mr. Baker because I have spoken to him 4 or 5 years ago about coming out to us, and thankfully, he has constantly. I like his slogan, Office of Community Relations, engage residents, encourage participation, expedite resolutions. I'd like to know where the hell is a daggone city council or the county council. Tonight, turn around and count how many people came here tonight. The county council does not meet at night. How can we participate? How can we engage our residents? How can we encourage participation? You remember me now, don't you? And it's not the county exec's purview to say that county council meetings need to be held at night. That's not, I'm just taking over a little bit. Because look at how many people come. And these many people can't come at 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, you're at work, you've got other commitments during the day. We need the county council to meet at night. If you want the participation, if you want to hear from us, you got to meet us halfway. I'm not asking for every meeting to be at night, but once a month, can you have people come out? Count how many people came to all of these hearings. People want to be engaged, but you can't disengage us and not be there. It's like asking school kids to show up to the county council meeting at 10 o'clock a.m. They're supposed to be in school. I'm supposed to be at work. There are some people, especially the most reliant on public transportation, can't get barely to work, must like to Upper Marlboro. Yeah. But meetings need to be held at night. If you want us to be there, you've got to make it available to us. I'm asking and want to inform you that if you can come out tonight, you'll come out another night. You will. You care about your community. These people didn't show up because they don't care. They do care. But you've got to meet us, County Council. You've got to be there at night. We can't come at 10 or 11 o'clock or 2 o'clock in the day. And the people who do come, they're paid professionals, they're paid lobbyists, they're paid attorneys, and that's who's in front of your face. You've got to hear from the residents and the people who elect you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Baker.
Next up, David Kahn, and on deck, Mario Whitaker.
Yeah, if I can, just Mel.
Just very quickly, and then you raise a good point. I do want to tell you, we have about four evening town hall meetings.
Yeah, we have four evening.
So we have four of them throughout the year. We probably need to have more. But we do have them. I just want to make it clear. We just had one, in fact. Where's that, Suitland, right?
Suitland High School.
Are they advertised here? Correct. Yeah, it was advertised. Now the question is, how do you find out about information? Some of it is in the county council.
Now, Mel, you got to sit down. We're going to make sure you hang around so we can answer this. But I just wanted to give the council member a chance to address that.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you for coming. Ms. Kahn.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Dave Kahn from Citizens for an Elected Board, and this forum was called by the county executive, so maybe it's not the best forum in which to ask our delegation to roll back the legislation that took away our control of our schools and gave it to him. But since you're listening, I'm going to ask for that anyhow. Okay? And I want to thank and congratulate Senator Muse and Delegate Braveboy for their courage in standing up to their colleagues and standing up for the citizens of Prince George's County by voting against that legislation. And I want to have applause for them. Now, when I told people I was coming here tonight, they said, shh, be quiet, because there's problems in the law that was passed. You know, you legislate, to change an aphorism, you legislate in haste and then you amend at leisure. So I'm going to ask for something to be done at the upcoming legislative session to improve this law, even though it might be better for my cause to let the school system twist in the wind. But I'm not like that. Supposedly, there is a clause in the legislation that allows the school board to override the superintendent. I'm sorry, we have to call him a CEO now. When they give us back the vote, they give us back a superintendent. That's not an override provision. If you look at it carefully, all it says is that with a supermajority, the school board can pass a policy that differs from the policy of the superintendent. Well, then you have two policies, each equally valid, because it doesn't say it overrides the CEO's policy. It doesn't say the CEO's policy is invalid. They're equal. So now you have staff who have two policies to guide them, and they may be totally different. So in the unlikely case that your appointees disagree with one another or have the intestinal fortitude to vote their conscience, you may wind up with a supermajority that differs from your appointed superintendent, and what do you do then? Now, let's take that a step further. You left the school board with a very few things to do. Among them were parent engagement and the academic advancement. What happens if they have a policy and he wants to go against them? Do they have to repass it with a supermajority, even though it's within their bailiwick? There's a lot of things like this because you've split the authority of the schools. Instead of them being resident entirely in the school board, the superintendent has most of the authority. So how are you going to reconcile these? The legislation needs to be fixed, and I'd be happy to work with the delegation to fix it, even though it may not be in the interests of getting our school board back to a wholly elected school board. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Mario Whitaker.
That is you. You're up. And you're ready. You got your jacket off and everything. It's like the Minutemen.
Yeah, my name is Mario Whitaker, and I came to this county in 76 from North Carolina, and I worked in the school system for 30 years, and I retired in 2011, and I worked in this school right here in 70, from 95 to 98. And the latest truth about the football field and the baseball field, it's ridiculous. And she's right about that, because when I worked here in 95, it looked bad. If they improving it, if they hadn't improved it since then, it's a shame. I'm serious, because you other schools, it's like professional fields. You go out here, you think you're in a cow pasture. I'm serious. That don't make no sense. And the lady said she walked down of Livingston Road. That dude near the sidewalk, on both sides, I came through the night, it's black dog. And you got people walking down there with the kids and the strollers. I said, where's the sidewalk at? And I see one man walking down the road. He walked back, facing the traffic. I said, he should be facing the traffic. And they're walking behind the traffic. So this county right here is behind on a lot of stuff for its road, kids going to school. I'm going to tell you something. I've been here, I retired. I'll be out in the street sometime from 10 o'clock in the morning to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Ask the average child, what's your learning day in school? I don't know. Now, that ain't right. You ask any child out here, I guarantee you go out here right there, go down Willow Road, top of the hill, on Willow and Southern Avenue, kids in front of them, begging for money. That ain't right. You know, ain't no summer, you got summer school, out of school, no programs for them at recreation. There's no kids. You get summer jobs. If they don't have a summer job by January or February, they ain't getting no summer job. You know, you go out here in summertime, all these kids, nothing to do, walk around idle. You ask the average child, who the vice president is? They can't even tell you. They can't even tell you. And I learned that in school. When I went to school in North Carolina, I learned how to read and write by the time I got to sixth grade. You ask these kids and seniors, how you fabrication now? They can't fabricate to get a job. Because you know why? Because they learned nothing in school. These schools I see is failing these kids. I worked in schools for 30 years. I saw waste. I saw favoritism. I saw all of that for 30 years. When I retired, I had to go out slowly. If I did, they would have fired me. I worked at Potomac, Langley Park, Eleanor Roosevelt, High Point, Landover Hills back in 81. I worked in school for 30 years. I can name them more than about a good 10 good teachers out of 30 years. I'm serious. And about the principals, Lord have mercy. It's all about who you know. I had a principal last year telling me the school system would be like a corporation. Lord.
Thank you oh, very Lord. Much. And you were right. You were ready.
The Peachy County is a disgrace.
Thank you.
Let me say something.
No, you can't. No. Your jacket's looking
time,
for you.
Sir.
Come on.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
You run for the U.S. Senate. Child Carmore.
You don't.
Child the man. Child the Democrat.
Go back up. We're watching your jacket from up here.
All right. All right, thank you very much, Mr. Whitaker. We're down to our last two speakers. And our next one is DeLondre Green. And on deck is Veronica
Veronica, you
have a gentleman back here as a hand.
I'm sorry.
Did you sign up, sir? He signed up.
You signed up, sir?
Wasn't called.
What's your name?
You signed up. What's your name?
Oh, David.
Tell them.
Okay.
Tell him his name.
You did sign up. We got you. Okay.
Okay. You registered online?
Registered online, sir? You registered online? What's your name? Okay. You'll be our last speaker.
Good evening. My name is DeLondre Green. I'm a student athlete at Potomac High School. I would like for you.
That's good.
You're good.
I would like for you to focus on not only just academics, but for needs of improvement for the athletic facilities, not only at Potomac High School, which I would like for you to take a look at, but for the entire PGC county, though. For a county that considered a wealthy and have a lot of money and stuff, we have the worst field in Prince George's County, but we go to D.C. public schools, they got turf and everything.
Yeah, all turf.
But when I come early Saturday to look at this field, I feel disgraced because the only thing we play on is mud and dirt. And then our track, it's real terrible. It's pitting, and we had the best full people in the county to play run track. They go to Temple, Hampton, and Florida State. We won the states in 2012, but we still didn't get no improvement. I've been playing here for 4 years. I still didn't see no improvement yet. Then. Also, consider having Friday night football, because the SAT is on Saturday, and we the only team that do not play Friday night football. And on Saturday, we got to focus on our games and the SAT. We take our SAT on the morning time. Then, after the morning time, we got to hurry up and rush to the game and hurry up and be on focus. So that's not fair for us. And if we play on Friday nights, it'd be more easy to, it would be saving money for the school system. and our administrator and counselor, and then be best for the student athlete, because we had a chance for colleges to visit different colleges. Because they, for example, for myself, I had Howard University invite me to their game, but I couldn't make it. But I had a game on Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock. So I had no chance to see how Howard played or see how the campus is. So thank you very much for your time, everything.
Thank you.
If I can, I'll limit my comments. $381, which is a bond bill that I put in, and we did get $125,000 toward that effort, and the county council persons are working.
She's next in the news, sir. She's next in the news. Mm-hmm. You're after her.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'd like to introduce myself again. My name is Veronica Davila. I am the president of Woods End Homeowners Association, which is a townhome community right at the top of the hill. I'm also your Democratic Central Committee representative for the 26th District, but I'm here tonight as a homeowner and as a longtime, lifetime resident of Oxon Hill. I want to touch on the TNI, working with Barry Stanton, our head over in this district. It's been a wonderful program. I just want to encourage you all, when you see the meeting signs go up, when we have our walks, please come out and join us to walk. We had a meeting where we only had two homeowners that come out to walk. We had more officers there, more support from the county agencies than we had residents. So come out, walk. Get to know your neighbors. Some people haven't even ventured over two streets over, so they don't even know their neighbors or what's in their community. One of the things that I do want to recognize in reference to the TNI, just driving here tonight, the bus stops, the metros, I heard a lot about transit. There needs to be lighting at these bus stops. Perhaps you can do a green initiative where maybe solar lighting. And I know Metro has, a lot to do with the funding and everything, but the bus stops, most of them are abutting dark woods.
Right.
There's no lighting, and safety is a concern. And that would be something nice. And the signs, what can we do about the signage? You can buy a car from $200 to $500 up and down St. Barnabas Road. I actually have pictures, I can send them, 57 pictures, over 150 signs from the Clarion Hotel to 28th Street on St. Barnabas Road. They stop in the car district, of course, but you can get your hair weaved, you can buy a car, you can have child care, whatever this case may be. And I would like to propose that I see some of the community hours with the corrections office, they're having them pick up the trash, they can snatch the signs down as well. Some of them will require cherry pickers because they've gotten, wise. And I guess they're doing them on the cover at night and they're, with the truck lifts. And I'm going to skip that because I want to get into the homeownership thing with the HOAs. It has to start from the top, from the developers, from parking planning to the developers to the council. There has to be something in place where you can see the developers coming in. If they have a long history, they've been building in the county from 10 years, 15 years, there has to be a history going with them. They cannot continually be allowed to be permitted, and these photo ops with, elected officials, groundbreaking ceremonies, we're coming into the community, and they're leaving a trail of dissatisfied inferior work. They're using cookie cutter HOA docs that they use from one county, one state to another. They haven't been updated in 10, 20 years. You can't have a fence, you can't have security lights in some instances, which are FCC, you can't have a dish. Well, FCC has changed that rule and you can. So something needs to be done from the top down. So before it comes to the homeowners, they're turning the associations over in bankruptcy because they've been in the community building 3 to 4 years. They haven't gone after, and I'll wrap up, they haven't gone after the homeowners haven't been paid, and they're locked into these pro bono attorneys, and they're bankrupt. So that's something else I'd like to see you to do, work with the developers and the properties.
Thank you, and thank you for your work with our TNI. We really appreciate that. And our central committee, Senator.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is David Alton. I've been in this county since 1970. Oh, I'm sorry. I've been in the county since 1973. I've purchased 3 homes, rented 2 homes. I've lived in Forestville, Fort Washington, and Clinton. I work in Washington, D.C. I work with a lot of people from Calvert, St. Mary's, Charles, Baltimore County, Baltimore City, Montgomery County. When you mention Prince George County, you get a strange negative impression from them. What I would like to see is where on WTOP, News Channel 8, and the county cable, where there's information given out about what's happening in the county, so people will get a positive attitude and a positive thought when they think of our county. I like to have it where when you turn on News Channel 8 and WTOP, they mention something good about our county. We always hear negative things, but they hear good things. Moving on, the county bus. If I'm wrong about anything, let me know. But the county bus runs 5 days a week. It doesn't run on Saturday and Sunday, but a lot of people in the county don't have transportation and they really count depend on the buses. On Saturday, I see people go to the stores, get the shopping cart, bring it over to the bus stop, lay it on the side, and sit on the cart until a Metro bus comes. Metro bus shows up, it's full. These people have the children and their luggage and everything. They can't get on the bus. I mean, like 8 to 12 people trying to get on that one bus. If the bus breaks down, they got to work double the time on getting home. Moving on to the police. I like to see our police department get double. I see a lot of police cars around the area, but the criminals know the car is there, but there's no police officer. I may be wrong about that, but if we double the police department, bring in the FBI, ATF, DEA, and let them have a substation in our county, we can even lower the criminal element a lot more. And also with detectives. In regards to roads, Old Fort Road, lived on it for 12 years. I'm still in that area for 27 years now. Road has never been paved. It's got ruts in it. Old Fort Road from east to west. When people come down Indian Head, if that road has an accident, they hit Old Fort Road and come around to get around it, and that road is unbelievable. No sidewalk, a few lights, but it's rough. Thank you for hearing me.
Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you for coming out.
Last speaker is James Muhammad.
Mr. Muhammad.
I want to thank our elected officials for being here, and I want to thank the citizens of Prince George's County for being here. I'm actually proud to be a Prince George's County resident, seeing that we are so involved in county politics and issues that affect our community. And what I would like to do is I would like to, Mr. Baker, I would like to propose, and I sent this to you via email, sir, and I also sent this to Councilman Mel Franklin, propose a change to the Maryland Traffic Code, specifically 19-103. I came across this Maryland statute by accident, literally. And what the statute does is does something very effective. And what it does is it gives immunity to operators of vehicles that are county officials, particularly ambulance, fire, and police officers. And it does that very effectively. But in studying this particular statute and comparing it to statutes of other jurisdictions, I found that it seems that the article was written to be brief rather than thorough. And in my particular instance, the way I found out about this article, it was a case of what I believe to be abuse of the statute, where I was in an accident with a Prince George's County police cruiser, and the police officer claimed immunity. And because of civil court, things that happened in civil court, there was no standard for proving that he qualified for this immunity. Even though the documentation said one thing, his testimony was sufficient to substantiate that he qualified for the immunity. So what I've done is I've taken the liberty of making some suggested changes to the transportation article, where it requires certain things to be demonstrated to qualify for this immunity. and the way that I would like to see this done. I don't want officers and ambulance drivers to be hindered by the changes. I want them to continue to enjoy the freedom to do their job, because their job is a very risky job. But at the same time, I don't think that a citizen who gets in a vehicle accident with a person that's protected by the statute should not be disadvantaged in terms of whether or not I get into an accident with a citizen versus citizen. We're on equal footing. But if I get into an accident with a police officer, we're not on equal footing. So I would like to propose some changes to that. And I've written up some proposed changes to the statute here that I've outlined and read the changes, please.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
I stand corrected. We do have one last person who did try to sign up, Mr. James Jim Broadley.
Broadley. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Mr. County Executive, Senator Muse, Delegate Ivey, and other legislators, and some of the members of CETA, South County Economic Development Association, such as Councilwoman Karen Toles. My name is Jim Broadley, and I'm the chair of the Legislative and Zoning Committee for South County Economic Development Association. On December the 5th, 2012, South County Economic Development Association Incorporated wrote a letter to you, Mr. County Executive, urging the expansion of the summer youth program. Your response was positive, and your Office of Community Affairs worked with us to design an expanded program. Beginning in early March of this year, the working group met several times in the county administration building in Upper Marlboro, and the size of the working group increased from the initial 10 to 12 members to about 25 to 30 members. Those participating in the group include various community-based organizations, the County Office of Human Resources, and various private sector representatives. At the meeting held on Tuesday, March 19th, 2013, the working group moved into the implementation phase of our planning. Subgroups were formed for specific tasks. A letter of appeal to the private sector was drafted for your signature, and collaboration with the Office of the State's Attorney on a jobs fair in May was initiated. The state's attorney's job fair was held on May the 4th, 2013 at Bowie State University, and it was very well attended and very successful. However, the draft letter for your signature was never signed, and the private sector was not asked to support this program. As a consequence, summer jobs were offered to only about 500 of the 4,000 youth who had applied for summer employment. Thus, the 3,500 young people were left to their own devices during the summer, hopefully to occupy the time in a productive manner. CETA believes we can do better than this. We recommend that the working group be convened as soon as possible to plan a strategy with the private sector and state and federal agencies in the county to achieve full summer youth employment. I just have one small paragraph here, since I'm the last one.
Yeah, thank you, Jim.
For the first time in the history of Prince George's County, we urge you, sir, to engage employers from both the public and private sectors.
Jim, my good friend, you know what I'm going to do? Since I know you and I'm going to know, I'm going to send Lori. He's going to get with you. We will work together. You're going to talk to him? So we'll make sure. Glenda Wilson, our chief of staff, will do that.
All right. Thank Thank you. Thank you very much.
Let me do this. First of all, I want to thank you for coming out, but let me turn it over real quick, and I'm going to apologize in advance. I've actually got to run out. But I'm going to turn it over to Senator Muse, and I know that a number of our residents from the southern part of the county are from the Philippines, and I know that's in a lot of people's mind. So as I thank you for coming out, I'm going to turn it over to Senator Muse to close us out, and I want to thank Delegate Ivey also.
Let me again thank our county executive for coming, and thank you for coming down. This is, as you know, Delegate Ivey, she has a tight schedule because she's now a candidate for lieutenant governor. But she comes from among us and from where we are. Thank you, Johnny. Good to see you, man. So what we're asking for is that we continue to work together. Thank you in the 26th district for having the biggest turnout, right? Thank you for that. Thank our local police officers. Would you thank them for turning out as well? And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Remember, you can submit testimony. Courtney's down here in the corner if you'd like to do that. Thank you very much for coming out, and drive safely home.